Hello, I'm Tom Scholey, editor of Match Fishing magazine, and you join me today at the beautiful Gunwade Lake at Ferry Meadows near Peterborough, where I'm going to talk to you about roach and skimmer fishing on the pole. Obviously, when you're tackling a vast, exposed piece of water like the Gunwade Lake here, there's quite a lot of things you need to actually think about in order to get the very best from your session. Right from your box setup, to the amount of pole you use, to the top kit length that you choose to use, whether you fish with a top kit, a top four or a top five, obviously depending on the depth and the weather conditions, ground bait mixers, rigs, feeding and presentation. And we're going to go through all those things to hopefully help you catch more the next time you're on the bank. Now, one question I get asked a lot about this kind of fishing is what ground bait mix to use. And it really all depends on the kind of day and conditions you're faced with. Today, for example, we've got a little bit of ripple on the water, but it's not too windy. So I wouldn't expect there to be too much tow. It's pretty close, or as close as you can get, to perfect angling conditions today, because you've got a little bit of ripple, which will make the fish feed confidently, but not so much wind that you're going to have a ripping tow on the water or anything like that that's going to mean you're going to tailor your mix to keep your feed on the bottom. So I'm going to want quite a light active mix today because I don't expect the water column to be moving too much. And the aim of this mix is going to be to pull fish into the swim and get them feeding. Now, there's two ways you can achieve a light active mix. You can either use ground bait that's particularly light in texture and fine, so that when it goes in, it naturally behaves in such a way that it breaks up and clouds the water column. Or what I prefer to do is to use a slightly coarser ground bait, more traditional sort of roach ground bait, but mix it on the dry side so that when it goes down, it breaks up in the water column, but it does ultimately settle where you want it and take the fish down with it. Now, I'm not a believer in using just one kind of ground bait. I know a lot of the anglers you'll see in magazines like Match Fishing just use Sensus ground bait, or just use Van den Eyen ground bait, or just use Dynamite baits. A lot of them are actually sponsored by bait companies, so they get all the bait for nothing, so it makes sense for them to do that. But for me, and for a lot of you out there, you've got the choice of a big array of ground bait on your tackle shop shelf, and you really should think about making the best of everything that different brands have to offer. Now, my favourite roach ground bait, or hybrid ground bait, of all time is this, Van den Eyen Secret. It's absolutely brilliant for roach. So the first thing into the bucket is going to be half a bag of Van den Eyen Secret. This is actually the black Secret, which helps to create a nice dark mix, but normally I'd use normal Secret. But today, because I'm adding growth guard-ons to it and a little bit of Friends Event Black, I don't mind something that's going to make the mix a little bit darker. Next thing in, this is a great all-round ground bait, really. It's something to bulk out a mix. I'd rarely use this on its own, but since it's growth guard-ons, roach seem to love it. So this is the next thing in there, half a bag of this. Finally, I'm going to use this stuff, Dynamite Baits Frenzied Hemp Match Black. Now, I know a lot of top anglers use this ground bait along with other things that might be provided by the sponsors. It's a great mix, not least because it darkens the mix up, but also got a really, really hempy smell. And as we all know, roach love hemp. So if I can get into it, I'll add half a bag of that to the mix as well. I just want to talk very briefly about two other things that I'm not actually going to use today, but a lot of anglers do ask me about them, and that's soil and leam. When should you add leam and soil to your mix? Well, they do two different things. First of all, both of them have no feed in them whatsoever. So whenever you add them to your mix, they dilute the feed content. So if you don't think maybe the fishing is going to be so prolific, or alternatively, if you want to introduce a very large volume of bait but not fill the fish up, you put leam and or soil into the mix. Now, soil does behave differently to leam in that it doesn't cloud off the bottom. It's very much a carrier. It sinks, it takes whatever's in it down to the bottom. So I mentioned earlier, if conditions were adverse, if there was a lot of tow on the water today, if it were really pulling through, if it were windy, I probably would actually put some soil into the mix. Conversely, lean does cloud. So again, if I thought the fishing were going to be a little bit more difficult, if I wanted a bit of cloud in the water, but again, if I wanted to also add a little bit of weight, adding lean to the mix would be a good way to do that. So I'm now going to get this mixed, and then we'll leave it to stand for about 20 minutes before we come back to it, riddle it, and then it's good to go. Now, before you actually add water to your ground bait, it's very important to mix the dry ingredients together, because the secret's a very sticky mix. So say, for example, you were to pour your water in and it were to hit a blob of secret before anything else, that'd all clog up. So really make sure you get your dry mixes together. And something I've just realised I've forgotten to mention, a crucial ingredient, I don't know how I could forget this. Whenever I'm roach and skimmer fishing on still or slow moving water, not on fast moving water, on still or slow moving water, I'll add this to my mix. Lane's Finest Brown Crumb. Now, I know Lane's of Coventry sourced this from a very good bakery in Wolverhampton. And I always add about half a pint of brown crumb to any mix for roach and skimmers. As I say, when it's still or slow moving water, it does actually help your mix break up a bit, brown crumb. So I'd be loath to add it if you're fishing in really fast moving water, but on a day like today, it's a must add. So I'm going to mix a good dollop of that into the ground bait as well. In terms of the water I use, I've seen some real strange fads over the years. I've seen people use bottled water. I've seen people use tap water at home. The truth of the matter is, I really don't think it matters what you use, but for me, the cheapest, simplest, easiest way of doing it is to use lake water. So I've just got this out of the lake behind us. Just going to add it very, very gradually to the ground bait and give it a good mix as I do so. Now, you're probably wondering, why aren't I using a drill? If I were mixing up an awful lot of ground bait, say I was planning on chucking in 20 balls and being dead aggressive or anything like that, then I would use a drill. But I'm sat on my own today, I'm mixing up probably in total 5, 6, 7 litres of ground bait, that's all. It's not a lot of bait, so there really is no need. And also, I always think, if you don't have to use a drill, don't use one, because all that noise and disturbance on the bank, it's got to have an adverse effect on the amount you catch on some occasions, so why take the risk? I'm giving it a good old mix with my hand. I'm going to get it fairly dark, fairly damp, should I say. Keep adding the water gradually. And importantly, in a minute, I'm going to leave it to stand for about 20 minutes while I go and set my gear up. And that'll give all the nice fish attracting particles in the mix time to soak up the water. And when I come back to it, it should be perfect. Right, now the mix has been stood for about 20 minutes. As you'd expect, it's dried out quite a lot. So I'm going to give it another little mix round. It's not actually too far away from how I want it, because I said I do want to feed it quite active today, so that means not over-wetting it particularly. I want it to create a bit of commotion as it goes down, a few bits come off it, but ultimately it's all to sink down to the bottom where it can form a nice bed for the fish to settle and feed over. I'm just going to add a little bit more water to it. Again, pour it around the edge, not too much, and then a good mix with my hand. Now the final stage before we actually use the ground bait is to riddle it, and that just makes sure that if we have missed any bits, if there's any bigger bits in there we don't want in there, or if there's any dry pockets of ground bait that maybe haven't got as wet as the rest of it, it's mixed up, evenly dispersed through the mix. So to do that, pour it into a spare bucket. Nice sensuous ground bait riddle here. Ground bait riddles are a little bit coarser than standard maggot or pinky riddles, as you can probably see. And we'll just do it bit by bit, so a couple of handfuls at a time. If you put too much bait on a riddle, it actually really slows down the process, so a couple of big handfuls. Any bigger bits, just ease them through with your fingers. And then what you'll be left with is a finished mix. And see that? And the beautiful thing about that, and the thing you're always looking for in this kind of situation, you can get the ground bait, give it a good firm squeeze like that, makes a ball, but you know it'll break up quite quickly as it sinks towards the bottom. One of the most important considerations when you come into a venue like Ferry Meadows with rugged, open, wild banks is the kit you bring with you and how you set it up to allow you to fish to the maximum possible efficiency. Now, first and foremost, you've got to get your box in the water and get it set up stably so it gives you a nice firm platform to work from. To a lot of anglers, that might mean using a platform, but for me, I fish with a Nordic Ockbox system, which has something called an outrigger, which you can see on the front there. Now, basically, that's a long bar that allows you to set up ultra stably in conditions like this. It extends actually to depths of up to 6 feet, although you never obviously want to use it like that in a situation like this, because in most matches, the rule is the deepest you can go to is your knees. So if you can imagine where that's set up now, it probably is about the depth of my knees. It's probably set about 2 foot off the bottom, with probably a foot of the leg protruding just above the surface. Now that's set up there. Behind it, I put some longer front legs in and longer back legs in. So you've basically got a more stable system than a platform, because obviously there's no second medium in between the box and the lake bed. It's just all set up, dragged back, and you can fish off that all day, dead solid. Now, second thing to think about is the tackle you're going to use and how you're going to cater for that. Most important thing is a bump bar. Now, as you can see, there's a bit of chop on the water today. There wasn't too much wind when we started getting set up, but it's actually picked up slightly since then, so I'd expect it to get even more strong as the day gets on. So a bump bar allows you to present your bait very still, hold your pole, but also when you're fishing with top fours and top fives, as I might well be later on today, when you net a fish and go to unhook it, you want somewhere to rest your top four. So even if it's not required from a fishing point of view, on natural venues, I like to have a bump bar set up. It gives you somewhere nice to rest your equipment as you're actually fishing, and makes you that bit more efficient on the bank. Other thing to talk about, obviously, you need a pole sock, which helps you fish efficiently, keeps that out of the way. I mean, I see anglers sometimes messing about trying to rest it on the draw or maybe wedging it in the keep net. Why? Pole sock like that, catch a fish, come back, put it in that. It's all about efficiency. Pole sock helps you be more efficient. And behind that, I've got one of the Ockbox pole rollers. Again, that caters beautifully to the terrain. It's quite difficult up there. We've got a rock, we've got three or four rocks, a sloping bank and a bush. But that really sort of allows you to fit that roller in between that terrain, thanks to a number of unique features, which you can probably see on your screen about now. Side table, obviously this is integral to the box, fits on the side there. Nice front plate there, which means my ground bait will be close to hand, should I want to feed another ball at any point today. And finally, a pole roost. Now the beautiful thing about a pole roost is, stops your top fours blowing away in the wind. Again, the wind's picking up quite strongly today. The last thing you want to be doing is getting up off your box to retrieve a top kit that's blown up behind you while you've been fishing. With this, the clip in place, I've actually rested them on the bank behind me. A more tarty angler would probably use a pole roost, but that's not for me. Get them in on your side tray on the roost, and then goes back into the bush. They're going nowhere for the rest of the day. So I should be able to fish from this station really, really efficiently. I'm going to talk a little bit now about rigs. Now, as you can see, when I spoke about ground baits and feeding, which was a little more than an hour ago, the conditions were flat calm. There wasn't so much as a wave on the water, odd little bit of ripple. And look at it now, you can see this curl is breaking. The wind's picked up, I'd guess, 5 or 6 mile an hour. I mean, of course, we're only probably 15 or 20 miles from the coast here in Peterborough. So when that wind pushes in from the sea, conditions can really change quickly. And you've got to be prepared for that. So in terms of rigs, first of all, I'm going to talk you through what I class as a very general rig for tackling a venue like this, and that's a round-bodied shaped float. This is a Sensus Series 18. Now, the only thing that will really change about that size of and pattern of about that pattern of float, should I say, depending on conditions, is the size of it. Now, today I've set up a 0.6 gram float, which probably looks a little bit light the conditions, but hybrids and roach can be finicky fish. And it's amazing how it's amazing how often, even in quite adverse conditions like this, you can drop in with a light rig, let it bounce about, you'll get a bite every chuck and come back with a fish. Whereas you go in with a heavier rig and you sit there like a pot frog. However, you have got to give yourself the option of fishing a heavier rig, because on other days you can really muller them. Obviously, the quicker you can get your bait to the bottom, the quicker you can catch. So on other days, a heavier rig's great. So that just means a Sensus Series 18 in 1.5 grams, which is a bigger float, can just about hold that still. Now, as the wind's picked up, obviously the toe's picked up as well, so it is pulling ever so slightly from right to left here, which is the opposite way to the wind. Doesn't present too much of a problem though. I can still hold the bottom in about 8.5, 9 feet of water with a 1.5 gram rig just fine. Important thing I would say about rig size, unless you know you're targeting a lot of tiny fish on the bottom, when a heavy rig gives you an obvious advantage because it speeds up the time it takes to get your bait to the bottom, don't go too heavy. You know, we're fishing for quality roach and skimmers today. Fish as heavy as you need to get your bait to the bottom and hold it there, which today means 1.5 grams float. The important thing to do though is to match your setup for the size of float you fish. And by that I mean, if you're going to fish a big float, step up your elastic accordingly, because obviously you're striking through more weight, both in terms of your Olivet and your float size. So this 1.5 grams rig is matched to a number 7 Preston Jura Hollow elastic, which I've got a 8-inch 08 hook length tied to 011 reflow power. Hook choice is a size 20 B560 by Camazan, which I think is a great all-round choice when roach and skimmers are the target. Now on that rig also, I've got a small Olivet. It's a 1 gram Olivet. I always like to cater the size of my Olivet. It's roughly 0.5 gram lighter than the size of the rig I'm using. And what that allows me to do is use a boom of shot, which not only helps to prevent tangles, but also gives you the option of creating more droppers if you want to by simply sliding the Olivet up the line and pulling your dropper shot down. So it just gives you a lot more adaptability when you're out on the bank. Conversely, on the 0.6 gram rig, a small bulk of shot's all that's needed. Bulk of number 8's on there. And again, because I'm using a lighter float, smaller shot will register better on a thinner bristle, so I can step down to number 11 droppers, which I've got 4 of, leading down again to an 8-inch hook length and a size 20 B560. Now, something I'm a big believer in when it comes to this kind of fishing is that you should always fish as light as you can. And by that I mean, a lot of anglers will say, oh, you can get a bite on 010, why would you fish 08? No. In my mind, I'll catch a lot more fish on 08 because I'll get a lot more bites on 08, I'll catch a bigger stamp of fish on 08, because we all know that fishing lighter does, on its day, make a difference. And it's all a varying degree of scale, in my opinion. Yes, you might get a few bites on 010, but very often, scale down to 08 and you'll get a lot more bites. So rather than thinking in terms of how heavy can you get away with fishing, think in terms of how light you can get away fishing. And by that, I mean, you don't really want to ever be getting broke, but if you've just got to take a little bit longer to catch a better stamp fish, then it's well worth doing. Give yourself the option. Always start lighter and go heavier. Get some bites, put some fish in the net, and from there, you can read your peg and work out what to do next. On the subject of fishing light, obviously, I've mentioned rig size today, and you very much have to cater it to the conditions you're faced with. So today, there'd be little point setting up anything lighter than a 0.6 float, because quite literally, it'd be pulled from pillar to post by the wind and the tow. However, I do just want to mention, if conditions were more like they were when we started doing the ground bait shot earlier, with just a little bit of ripple on the water, or even if it were flat calm, I would definitely be setting up a strung out rig, a lighter pattern. I've got a couple here to show you. 4x14's Preston Chianti is one, and the other is a much lighter 4x10 Preston Chianti. And then have those strung out with number 10 or number 11 stocks, and that gives you a totally different mode of presentation, and one which can prove devastating on its day. Not least because with this lighter rig, the 4x10, you stand a good chance of catching some fish up in the water. And when conditions are less favourable, fish have much more of a habit of coming up in the water to intercept loose feeders. They're less confident about feeding on the bottom. However, today we're trying to achieve something totally different, because that's what conditions dictate. We're trying to pin the fish to the bottom and catch them there, which is why we've opted for these bigger bodied patterns with droppers. Well, the rigs are set up, the ground bait's mixed, we're just about ready to start. First, I just want to talk a little bit about bait choice for this kind of venue. And again, it is determined by conditions. There's certain things that you always need to have with you when targeting roach and skimmers on a large natural water like this. First things first. Most important bait, in my book anyway, is these things. Good quality casters. I get mine from Lane's Baits in Coventry. and they're always in tip-top condition, which I think is very important when it comes to, you know, trying to catch wild natural fish. You don't need loads for a session, 2-3 pints. If it's flat calm and you were thinking of fishing shallow, maybe a few more, but you don't need a lot. Second, pinkies. I like to kill mine for feeding with ground bait on days like today, which I do by just freezing them in a bag overnight. Dead pinkies make a great addition to your ground bait, help to hold fish in your peg, and they're irresistible to fish like hybrids, even skimmers and roach as well. Next up is hemp. Now this stuff can be quite dangerous in that I see a lot of anglers loose feeding hemp on venues like this. Now, there's no denying roach, hybrids love hemp, but there's just a little bit of a danger if you start spraying it about everywhere, they get preoccupied by it. So my advice would be, feed it in your ground bait by all means, but unless you want to try and catch some fish on hemp, and don't get me wrong, it's a deadly bait, unless that's your purpose, don't loose feed it. So today I'm going to feed some in my ground bait, and that'll be the only hemp that gets introduced to the peg. But again, it's a nice, heavy, oily, fish-attracting holding bait that'll hold roach, hybrids and skimmers in the peg. Other than that, I've got some maggots for the hook. And the other thing I've got with me is some worms. Again, these are absolutely deadly, a real potent fish attractor. But I always like to keep these up my sleeve. And by that, I mean, I won't feed any worms at the start. The start of today, I'm going to cup 6 balls of ground bait in from a height. I'm not going to ball it. If it were flat calm today and I'm looking to draw some fish in, because I mean, I think fish tend to sort of spread out. And when it's flat calm, you can really draw them in by balling it. But today, accuracy is going to be premium in this wind. So I'm just going to cup 6 balls in from a height, but they won't have any worms in them. However, later on in the day, it might be that I feel my swim needs a bit of a boost. It might be that I feel that there's some skimmers present that I'm maybe not capitalising on by just fishing casters and maggots over ground bait. Then I'll put a ball rich with chopped worm in. But for now, I'm going to leave them out. But believe me, these will, I think, come into play later in the day when I want to give my peg a little bit of a boost. And finally, the ground bait. Now, when I spoke to you at the beginning, I talked about a flat, calm day. I talked about, you know, how I wouldn't need to add any soil in it, but I spoke before about being adaptable. As you can see, the wind's really picked up. So I will be adding a small quantity of soil to this mix, just to make sure it gets down, because it's quite a strong right to left toe. I don't think it'll do any harm at all, just to add, I'll probably add about a third soil to 2/3 ground bait. So not too much soil, but it's just going to make it weighty. It's going to get it where I want it to be. After all, today I'm trying to concentrate fish on the bottom and catch over the top of it. So adding a bit of soil to the ground bait will be a really good thing in my opinion. Let's get fishing. I've just added some casters and pinkies into my ground bait. I'm just going to add a large handful of hemp now. Lovely holding bait this is, so I'll put plenty in there. Might be that I knock another mix up a bit later, so I'm not going to use all of it, but a couple of generous handfuls, probably about half a pint, I'd say, of hemp in there, which I'm mixing around with the pinkies and the casters. Again, you just got to make sure that it's very evenly dispersed right through the mix. Really, I suppose you should get off the box and throw it all in a bucket and do it that way, but it takes a couple of seconds longer, and I won't disturb the peg just by doing it sat on my box here. Right, so that's all now nicely dispersed. I'm just going to make 6 balls. Again, these are quite nice and dry still, so they do need some firm squeeze. But you can see there, that's a nice solid ball, and the weight of the soil is really going to help it get to the bottom. Make half a dozen of these, and I'm going to pot them in and get fishing. Something I do just want to mention that I've seen a lot of anglers get wrong when it comes to cutting pole sections back. Always, always make sure your cupping kit is the same length as your top kits. I see people sometimes with a cupping kit that much shorter and they're trying to mess about and hold the pole this much, you know, further behind where they're fishing. Just save yourself all the hassle. Cut your cupping kit back, same length as your top kits. And when it comes to feeding, all you have to do is drop a ball in the pot, ship out to the distance that you know you're fishing. Obviously, when you're cupping a weighty object out like this ball of ground bait here, just make sure that all your sections are really firmly together. And then Hold it from a height, line up with your far bank marker. Let it make a nice splash as it goes in like that. That gives you all the advantages of balling it, because you're getting a nice fish attracting noise. But obviously, you've also got the accuracy factor there as well. So, just going to follow that out with another five now. Some people talk about trying to make a line or a triangle or different kinds of formations when it comes to putting bait in. I don't believe for a second that these balls end up exactly where I'm putting them in. If you ever watch any underwater footage, they spin off at all sorts of jaunty angles. So put them in from a height on your marker and just be prepared that some are going to go 2 or 3 feet one way, some are going to go 2 or 3 feet the other. But all you're doing is trying to be as accurately as you possibly can in the conditions. You're creating a nice big area of bait, of course, because the balls will break up when they get to the bottom. One other good point, actually, about accuracy when we're talking about it. If, say, you were feeding less balls than this, something like with bloodworm, and accuracy really is of a premium, a good little tip is to make your ball so they just snugly fit into your pole pot. I sort of do it as standard now, but you can see I have to push that in. Now watch, when I ship out, what'll happen is, I'll turn the pole pot over and the ball won't slide out straight away. I'll have to actually turn it over and hold it for a second. Watch. Now watch, when I tap the pole, the ball drops out. The beauty of that is, the ball falls straight down in the water. There's no spin. If you imagine a ball rolling out of a pot, it straight away has a spin. If you just have a loosely fitting ball in a pole pot, I'll do it like I do. It's just to demonstrate I'll do it this time, because I say accuracy is important today, but it's not the be all and end all, because we're putting quite a volume in. If you watch this now, when I turn this pole pot over, that ball will roll out. And did you see how that was spinning? Imagine what that's going to do if it falls through the water. It's going to make it veer off. But we are creating a little bit of an area today. So it's not absolutely critical that that's done perfectly. I think it's always important. See, a lot of people ball ground bait in and then go on another line or do something similar like I just have. Obviously, the effect you're creating is making noise, bringing fish in. See, people do that often and then leave it. I always wonder why. You know, you've just created an instant attraction there. Always best, in my opinion anyway, to go straight on it and just see what that initial attraction's brought in. If after 3 or 4 fish, you don't get another bite on it, you can always do something else. But to me, you've done the hard bit. On some venues, on some particularly hard days when you're doing this kind of fishing, them early fish you catch after balling it can be the only fish you catch. So it's always important, in my opinion, to go straight on your balls. And let's just see what they've brought in. Didn't take too long for a bite anyway, bite pretty much straight away there. Presentation is a little bit tricky in this wind, but I spoke earlier about the importance of a pole support, and it just makes it so much easier. There's absolutely no pressure on me or the pole there. It's just rested in that nice groove, and I can just let the bait bounce over the feed until one intercepts it. Presentation really is about as good as it can be in the conditions by using a bump bar in that way. Straight away we're into a fish. And it's come off. Not the ideal start, but never mind. At least we know there's a few there. I think that was a hybrid as well, by the way. It ran out into the lake. You know, it's often a giveaway sign that there's hybrids in your peg. and you hook them and they charge out. A bit like F1s really, I always think. Again, for rig control, it can often be easy just to sink the tip of your pole slightly underneath the surface, but just be careful if you do that. You don't want it to fill up with water because that can lead to breakages on the strike, but you kind of get a feel for a pole when you fish with it. I know that that won't really happen with this. It's got quite a small bush in there, so. Another little bite there on the drop. So I can tell straight away that that initial feeder ground bait dropped in from a height, it's brought some fishing, which I'm happy about. I think we're going to catch some fish today. Not quite the target species, a little bleak that, but over the second fish will be a little bit more substantial. That's a better fish. This is what it's all about. Look at these. Not the biggest, nonetheless, a beautiful little silver marine. Lovely. Well, this really is lovely, lovely fishing here at Fairbedders. Getting these little hybrids, odd roach, odd skimmer, every single put in. And to be honest, that initial bombardment as it was, probably won't be a great need to change anything. Probably half an hour or so after that initial feed, hopefully even longer. As long as you're going in and getting a bite, every single put, you know, there's no point to there's no point overcomplicating things. I do see anglers sometimes on venues like this. We'll throw the balls in, ship out, catch a fish. Straight away, they'll start loose feeding over the top. And I always just think, just take a little minute, you know, get yourself set up, catch some fish, get a feel for what your peg's doing, and then decide. And as long as you're putting fish in the net, you know, you can guarantee, I'll almost guarantee you'll probably be building a lead on a lot of the competition, so that's always been my approach. Because of the wind, gram and half rig's a little bit better today, or seems to be. I've actually tightened up that 7 elastic that I started on, which has just allowed me to swing nearly everything I hook to hand, apart from the real bigger samples. Interestingly, a single caster is the best hook bait straight away today. And main reason for that, there seems to be a proliferation of bleak over the feed area, which means that as I'm putting the rig in, often a fishing maggot or a pinky is getting mullered by a bleak, but a caster just seems to avoid the retention a little bit and get down to the bottom. In terms of presentation, there's not really a lot I can say. I mean, normally it's crucial to put your rigging in the right way, but the downside of conditions like this is obviously can be difficult to hold your pole, although with a bump bar it's quite easy. But the plus side is you can often get away with doing things a little bit cruder. If for no other reason than you don't have a choice, you've got to just try and get your Olivet as close to where you're fed as possible. Your rig will then move down over that spot. And that's the key to catching. I'm still getting the odd fish now. We're about half an hour, 40 minutes into the session, I'd say. The stamp seems to have got smaller. I seem to be getting the odd bleak in there as well. So I think what's happened is the bait's actually starting to run out. The fish are feeding that aggressively. They've probably mopped up a lot of the free offerings that are in the ground bait. I don't believe they've eaten all the ground bait. All the dead pinkies, the casters, the hemp, etc. that I put in there to start with have probably now gone. And I'm going to take a gambit and say, if I pot in a bait, a ball, should I say, rich with loose feed, those fish will be straight back on it and it'll really accelerate my catch rate. Now, working out how to top up is perhaps one of the most difficult decisions any angler has to face when it comes to a session like this, because generally you do get that initial run of fish that I've just enjoyed, but then deciding whether to loose feed or cupping balls is difficult. Loose feeding today is totally out of the question to me. We've got a strong wind, we've got a strong tow. I don't know where that bait would end up. So it's going to be a rich ball, just like this one, that I'm going to pot in on that line and just gauge the response, really. Now, already in the back of my mind, I'm starting to weigh up how the session is going and what I think I might be able to do later to either increase or maintain the catch rate if anything should happen in terms of slowing down or smaller fish, etc. One thing I think will work particularly well today, I spoke about it at the start, is the cupping in of balls rich with dendrobenas, chop worm. Now the reason I'm not doing it straight away is, as I've said, I'm catching quite well. You know, it did slow up a little bit there, but I'm fairly sure my bait's just starting to run out. So I'm going to go back in over the top of the same initial mix, rich with loose feed, and try and put a few more fish in the net. But later, I really do think cupping in some balls rich with worms will be good. Another reason I think they'll be good, the only problem I'm really having today is probably after every three or four hybrids, I'm catching a bleak, which you don't want. So I'm having to fish a caster on the hook rather than a maggot, because a maggot seems to attract their attention much more than a caster. I just think if I could fish a piece of worm, it'd give me all the advantages of a maggot, i.e. soft, they can suck it in easy, but also it's a lot more resilient. You know, once a maggot's been sucked by a bleak, you don't generally get another go with it. You've got to come in and rebait. There we are, you see, straight after that top up ball, I'm into another hybrid. Show just how aggressively, and it's a better stamp, just going to show how aggressively these fish are feeding today. It's actually a roach, that one. You know, but the average stamp of fish I've had today must be 3 or 4 ounces, I'd say, so 4 to the pound, 5 to the pound. Doesn't take many to build a big weight. Well, we're about an hour and a half into the session now, and a couple of things have changed with the way the peg's sort of fishing. First and foremost, seems a lot of the fish that I've been catching have been bleak, basically. I'm getting plagued by them. They're intercepting the bait in the upper sort of third or two-thirds of water. I'm not managing to get my bait down to where the bigger hybrids are. I mean, this is actually a little perch, but the target's obviously hybrids and better roach. And when a bleak grabs hold of your bait halfway down, obviously, it's no good. So, I've done two things to try and combat that. First thing I did is I set up a heavier rig. I've now got a 3 gram perfect Gloucester on. They're on about a foot away from the hook, and two number eights right above the hook length. And it's worked to an extent. I've just had three better hybrids by doing that. And you'll also notice I've come a little bit closer in. And the reason for that, as you can see, the wind's continued to pick up. It's not so much that I can't really hold the pole long, because I can. It's just the fish are obviously feeding very aggressively when they're coming to bait. And because it's the same depth at 7 metres as it is at 9 metres, there's absolutely no reason to ship past where the fish are obviously happy feeding. So I just figured if I can fish a bit closer, makes sense. It also just allows, because the wind's slightly in my face, to push my rig out past my feed like that and hold on to it so that I know my piece of worm is dead over where I've fed. And that's the third thing, if you haven't already guessed it. I've started feeding a little bit of chopped worm in with the ground bait and soil that I've was introducing earlier. Two reasons for that. First of all, I thought it might actually coax a few of the bigger hybrids and roach into feeding. But also, obviously, a bigger piece of worm's a more resilient hook bait than a maggot or a caster. So it's helping me to get down to the bottom and through to some of the better fish that are in there. It really seems to be working quite well. As you can see, there's some lovely stamp perch. It might be a perch, this one. I had a perch about 6 ounces of it earlier, but... No, it's a skimmer. Welcome bonus. So just in the corner of the mouth. That. Most welcome. Well, we're just over halfway through the session now, and to be honest, the last probably half an hour, 40 minutes has been about the slowest it's been all day. I've only probably put 4 or 5 fish in the net, but they've all been decent fish, quality hybrids. Obviously, I had a skimmer, which you saw, about 1.5 pounds. And a decent perch. It's often the case on venues like this that the middle of the day is the slowest point, but the key is really just to keep thinking and keep putting things in the net. Now today, we're going to have to doctor that thinking slightly, because normally I'd be saying try a lighter rig maybe, or you know, try loose feeding, but just the presence of those bleaks making it very, very tricky to do anything that doesn't involve bombing a bait down to the bottom. So all you can really do is keep topping up with rich balls of bait with feed and fish over the top. Now, one thing I do believe, as I've sort of mentioned already, that gives you peg a little bit of a boost is feeding chopped worm. And although I've been doing it for about an hour, I think it's very important to regularly chop worms. And by that, I mean, I know a lot of anglers believe that you can chop worms up at the start of the session into a tub and then just dip into them through the day as you go on. I actually think that's wrong, simply because the amino acids in worms, once that they're exposed to the air, they start to go off. And I actually remember having a very interesting conversation with Lee Edwards about eel fishing, and he believes that for eels, for the same reason, you're better off with old worms. So he always chops a load of worms up as soon as he gets to the bank and then fishes with them like that. But it definitely has an effect on the way that the bait behaves. So every sort of half an hour, I've been chopping up a fresh 250ml pot of worms and just adding it to the ground bait, making a fresh mix. And the way I see it, that as well, it keeps your ground bait nice and active, because you're not constantly using the same stodge you mixed at the start. You know, it's going to keep active, it's going to break down, and it's just another nice little edge for you. So again, a nice worm rich ball, firmly squeezed, full of worms. And I'm going to put that in on my marker. I mentioned earlier, obviously, the importance of accuracy, but when there's fish like bleak involved, I think it's even more important to be deadly accurate, because your windows of catching fish are quite limited. And by that, I mean, I'm feeding dead land with a blue boy over there, so that needs to go down smack bang on it, and it has done. When I put my rig in, my Olivet needs to be smack bang in line with that same boy, because a bleak will probably try and snaffle it in the top couple of feet of water, and if it gets to the bottom, it's probably a bit of a bonus. And even more so if it goes down miles away from where I'm fishing, it's just white, wasted time. So I need this to be spot on where I've fed. Oh. Well, I've got to say, although today's not been the easiest day I've ever had fishing, it's probably been among the most enjoyable because I've really had to work for every fish. I've caught some real quality fish, quality hybrids, a nice skimmer. Most of the fish I've had, with the exception of the Rogue Bleak, of course, have been a nice stamp. But more importantly, it's not been simple. When I arrived here this morning, saw a flat, calm lake, I thought we'd be fishing 4x10, 4x12, 4x14 Chiantis, fishing through the water, maybe even shallow, the Roach and hybrids. As it's turned out, it's got progressively stronger through the day. We've ended up catching fish like this, fishing rigs between 1.5 and 3 gram, fishing on the bottom with ground bait. We've really had to ring the changes in terms of feeding to make them fish keep coming. And I think that's where the key lesson lies when it comes to attacking big natural venues like this. You've got to be prepared to be adaptable. And sometimes that means getting up off your box and setting up a new rig. Sometimes it means totally changing your feeding pattern. But that's the great thing. It's like a never-ending jigsaw, really. There's always parts of the puzzle that you can drop in to make a big difference to the amount you catch. I hope you've enjoyed the day, and I'll see you soon.